Guess what time it is? Math Homework Hotline, where we do the math. Welcome back, you guys. Our first show of 2020. We're so excited.
Wow!
I know. We're so excited that you are with us. My name is Maggie Mixon.
And I'm Hannah Hanna, everybody. Welcome to our new season, new semester, new year. We're very happy to be here with you.
All right, listen. We have teachers right now waiting for you to call in. So call in because they can take your questions on any math topic. You're wondering, hey, how to do that math tonight? Call in. They're waiting for your phone call. So 813-840-7260. It's right there on that screen for you. So don't let them down. And by you calling in, you get a chance to win, ta-da, one of these snazzy t-shirts that do the math with our logo on the back. So not only are we available right now to answer any of your phone calls on any topic, but you can also take us on the go on mhh.mysdhc.org. So maybe if you're watching from a different state or you're out of town, you're like, oh, I don't want to miss any of my math. Exactly. Tonight's topic, definitely an important one for our geometry folks. Are you ready? What is the topic tonight? Yeah. Transformations, dilations, and similarity. So translation, reflection, rotation, dilation, similar figures, and scale. Again, that is a mouthful. Transformations, dilations, and similarity. What's that all about tonight? Thanks to our Mathnasium sponsor, we have our challenge question related to this very topic, and Hannah's gonna let you know about that.
All right, we have a very interesting challenge question, everybody. It's not really a challenge, it's very simple, easy to do. But with this particular topic, we need numbers. So I put it in a way where we can call in with a number and give the answer and be the winner. And you can do that. Let's take a look at the challenge question. It's about translation. And translation is one of the easiest ever transformations. Let's take a look. It says, if translation T, which is to send or to map the point order pair X and Y into the order pair X plus 5 and Y minus 8, fill in the blanks. We have a translation T, that same translation T, would send that point or map that point order pair 20 and 50 to what? We want you to come up with the order pair that is missing, two numbers. Would make an ordered pair for the point, which would be the image of this point, ordered pair 20 and 50, with this translation T that makes point X and Y, ordered pair X and Y, go to ordered pair X plus 5 and Y minus 8. You can do it. We're waiting for your call. Hopefully, you do it and call with the right answer. The first person to call with the right answer will be declared as our challenge question winner for tonight, and that could be you. Yes, I can look you in your eye and say that's you. I'm talking to you in person. Call us. We're waiting for your call. Back to you, Maggie.
And guys, basically by calling in, be that first one to get that right answer, be able to explain it to one of our teachers on the phone. Not only are you declared the challenge winner, but you also get all sorts of goodies. Our Mathnasium tumbler, Jenga, this little squeezy foam stress reliever, and yes, a t-shirt. But the most interesting is you get a certificate for being able to take one of their diagnostic assessments. So definitely be calling in because there's lots of goodies and you get to brag about that at your school. Our very last show of 2019, we had somebody from Pierce Middle call in Ms. Feliciano's class, and she was able to get that answer so you could be that winner too. It was Alicia, from Ms. Feliciano's class at Pierce. So shout out to them. So that could be you tonight. Also, what teacher is gonna have the most number of phone calls in? That's gonna declare that teacher the teacher of the week. So our very first week here back on the air for 2020. Are we ready to get some math going? I know we're ready. Ready to do the math. All right, Hannah, let's do this. Here I have what's called a Frayer model, and using this word transformations to build out from that, what in the world is transformations? Because we're using a lot of big words today, right? First off, a transformation up here, top left, involves moving an object from its original position to a new position. Now, we're going to be talking about graphs today, so we do encourage you to use either something like this, that is a board that has the little pegs and you can move them around very quickly. My x and y axis do shift on this, and I'll show you about that in a little bit. But then those objects that we're talking about truthfully are going to be different shapes that you put on a graph. So graph paper can help, definitely to help visualize that. When we're talking about transformations and moving this object that we've already placed on one of the quadrants or on the x-axis, y-axis, the basic four are going to be called either a rotation, a reflection, a translation, or a dilation. So those are the basic four ones that we do cover, and you may have heard those when I was introducing the topic for tonight. Now be careful, because when we're looking at these, sometimes it's called a rigid transformation, where we do not change the shape or the size. So for instance, something that you see here on this pegboard, this blue one, this little triangle, if you notice, I did a reflection on the y-axis, so I did a mirror image over from the y-axis. Remember, the y-axis is the vertical one down that center. So if you notice, my triangle with the blue pegs is the same distance from that y on both sides. So this becomes what's called the image. This one is the pre-image, the first one, and then the image. We'll get more into how do you actually know what's there. Notice that the size did not change. The shape did not change. So that's what's called a rigid transformation. When we look at non-rigid, we're going to change the size, but not the shape. I'll give you an example. When we do this word dilation example, if I do a dilation, it sounds like something's getting bigger, right? Think about when you go to the eye doctor. Your eyes get dilated. They get bigger. But with the word dilation, you might actually see a picture go smaller if you have something that looks like a triangle. Let me draw one there for you real quick. And I end up shifting this into a smaller triangle. It's still going to be called a dilation, but each of the side lengths was multiplied by some number that made it smaller. As you would guess, that smaller number was a fraction. Like for instance, this one could have been like a half. Like here, if this distance was 4, my new triangle, if it was a scale factor or it's, you know, similar type of fraction where it went into a smaller size, the shape didn't change, but the size did. Dilation, it doesn't always go from a bigger picture to a smaller picture. Sometimes you'll have it go the other direction, from something bigger, smaller to bigger. It just depends, what did you multiply by? What's that scale factor, if you will? So with that being said, I will tell you, very exciting, we already have a challenge winner! Hannah, you made it too easy tonight. All right, who is on the phone?
Well, I tell you who is on the phone right now. It is Laura. Laura,
yes.
Hello.
Hi.
Welcome to Math Homework Online, and congratulations to being our challenge question winner for tonight. I cannot.
Yay.
Very proud of you, Laura.
Thank you. I'm sure
your math teacher right now is very proud if he or she is watching. I hope they are watching. Tell us, what is your order pair as a final answer?
I got 25, 42.
Order pair, 25 and 42. And this makes Laura, everybody, the challenge question winner for tonight. Very proud of you, Laura.
Thank you.
Let's explain it to everybody has how you ended with this beautiful right answer here. That the problem started with a translation, T. This translation is supposed to take the order pair X and Y here, this is T, supposed to take order pair X and Y into the order pair that is X plus 5 and Y minus 8. So here is the order pair that I wanted you to come up with, the image of. I wanted you to take care of this order pair 20 and 50. Could you explain to our friends watching how you ended with this result here?
Well, the key said that you have to add 5 to x and subtract 8 to 50.
You subtract it from the y, right?
Yeah, from the y.
And where is your x here, Laura?
The x is 20.
Correct. So what would happen to the 20 when you apply the x plus 5? It becomes?
25.
Correct. That's 20 plus 5. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
I'm very proud of you. And I want to explain to everyone along the way, so you're sharing your answer and they are following up your steps. Great. Can you explain to them how you got the 42 as well?
So also with the key, it says that 50 is x. And so you have to subtract.
Hold on. Hold on. 50 is the what?
Oh, sorry. 50 is y.
Correct.
I'm so sorry.
That's right.
And then you have to subtract the 8.
Correct. So
from
now
the 50.
50 minus 8 is what?
42.
And now we can announce that Laura is the challenge question winner for tonight. Be await for your gift with your math teacher. And if I were you, I would email my math teacher right now and ask him or her, is my gift there yet? Stop. I got you to laugh. Thank you so much, Laura, for calling. And thank you for being the challenge question winner for tonight. You are an amazing student. Keep up the hard work and the good work. And keep watching Math Homework Online. Good night. See that she's gone.
Oh, my gosh, you guys. Laura Smithy. Laura, thank you so
yes.
much for being our winner for the very first time of 2020. Very exciting. She's at Martinez Middle. So
great.
Here we go, you guys. I'm going to tell you, not only can Laura do questions with us on air, you can call too with any question. It doesn't have to be in tonight's topic and request that either Hannah or myself work it with you. All right? So with that being said, I'm going to go back to what I had started with originally here on my board with that little yellow pegboard, but then taking it to where we can actually work with it. Because I don't know about you, but I wouldn't be carrying one of these around in my back pocket or in my purse necessarily. So I would be able to sketch it though. We're going to talk about how did we get from that original image or pre-image into the images or that you see here, okay? So first off, when we have our coordinate plane, this is what this is called, the x-axis, like I said, is your horizontal, the y-axis is your vertical. They may sometimes give you that picture, other times they may describe it to you, but you got to be able to name those points. Because just like with Hannah did on air, he was able to describe what happens to those new images, what is the actual point. So let's go ahead and remember, I'm going to take the board off for a little bit, that these points are called ordered pairs. And you have an x and a y axis. An ordered pair, the order matters. So x's go first and then y's. So you go side to side first and then up and down. You always start at the origin, move sideways, move up to get to your first point. So that first point, how would I name it? If you notice, I tried making it really clear for you. I only labeled certain parts of my graph, so that could be less worrisome as to what line is where. So here, if I go over from the origin 2, it's 2 to the right, so that's a positive 2. So A is located at 2, comma, and how many did I go up? Well, I went up to a positive 2. So my original pre-image, this is that pre-image, is at 2, 2. What about B? All right, take a look at it. B is up here. I went from the origin to the right 2 spots, so that's the X, went up to 6. Awesome sauce. And then C was that third point, 4, comma what? 2. Now, again, sometimes you're just going to be given those coordinate or those ordered pairs, and you would have to put it in your coordinate plane if you want to see it, if you want to visualize it. But once you've gotten experience with this, you may be able to go straight from that pre-image to what the actual image is. So when I had done it on my pegboard, there was 2 extra triangles. And the first one happened to be like that. Now these are going to be labeled A prime, B prime, and C prime. It's almost like the little accent mark that goes behind the letter. So how did I get to that? First of all, what kind of reflection was that? This is a mirror image. And if asked, the map, the new triangle, was reflected over the y-axis. So this is a y-axis reflection. With that reflection, where are your new points going to be? Well, A prime, you would call that B prime and C prime, again with those new ordered pairs. If I am for A, 2 to the right and 2 up, that's going to have to be the same distance on the y-axis. So as a reflection, turn it over here. So these are mirrors if I were to bring these up, right? So I went over negative 2, up 2. So this new point's going to be negative 2, 2. All right, what happened with B? I went over negative 2. It's the same distance from the y-axis. And then up how many? 6. And then for the C prime, I went over 4 to the left. That was negative 4, and then up how many? 2. So I want you to take a look. What's the pattern that you notice? My pre-image with a y-axis reflection, how do these points differ? Well, if you're taking a look real close, all of the y-values are the same. The only thing that's changed was those x-values, and they just became the opposite. So with the x-axis reflection, no matter what point you're given, you're going to end up with a negative x is what we call it, or the opposite of x.
You mean the y-axis reflection.
The y-axis. Did I say x-axis?
Yeah.
I apologize. So with y-axis reflection, your x's are going to be the opposite number, and the y's are going to be the same. I'll show you when we get back to this board in a few minutes how it would have looked had it been an x-axis reflection. So here, again, the mirror image being here, that's a y-axis reflection because that y is the line that if you would bring both of these up, would be that mirror. All right, back to you, Hannah.
Well, thank you. We're going to do a quick translation question once again to confirm what Laura taught us. We're all learning. I learned a lot from my students. I'm learning a lot from Laura as we speak. Right now, we have a translation question. Let's take a look and apply exactly what Laura directed us to do. Here's the translation. The translation in this case will take the ordered pair x and y, map it into. Learn this word, map it into. All right? Mapping is about functions, and this is a real function, okay? You'll learn more about functions later on. But now we just use the word map, which is a word related to the function studies. This translation maps this order pair into this order pair. I had to scratch this because if I apply this, the image's points would be out of range here. You would not be able to see it. So I changed my numbers and I made, instead of y minus 7, I went y minus 4 so we can all see it. So now, here's A. And by the way, when we come to grids like this, you are okay, you are allowed, you are authorized. That's not cheating, not violating any rule, by when you count by finger, but with your fingertip, okay? So go with this x. Without even worrying much about the ordered pair A itself, I can just do the application here. X, add 10 to x. So from here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then what? Then go down 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and put A here. So here is A prime. Do the same for B. Go to the right 10 and down 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4. C. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is C prime. This is B prime. And now D prime. Where is D prime? You count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4. Here is D prime, everybody. Then you get your ruler and you connect. For the sake of time, I'm going to connect by hand, and I know you know how to connect with your ruler and pencil. I'm not doubting this. But because of the time factor, we are actually tied with the time very much. Here is connecting by hand just to speed up a little bit the process. Okay? This is the image of this original trapezoid. A trapezoid has an image of trapezoid by this translation, everybody. We're going to move on to the next question with Maggie, and we have more of this to share with you. Go ahead, Maggie.
All right, you guys, so excited that you're here with us tonight. And again, continuing with our transformations, I wanted to show you what it would look like to have an x-axis reflection. So before we saw a y-axis reflection, while you were talking to Hannah, I had moved over what I had done before to the other side of the board, so now you could see what it would look like with an x-axis reflection. This again is our pre-image. Now we're going to reflect on this line, that x-axis. So basically all the points are going to be the same distance away from what was originally there. All right, if you notice, I have not labeled my axes, and these are just rough sketches. If you recall from the beginning of the show, when I said that the shape didn't change, the size didn't change, that would be a reflection. That was a rigid type of transformation. All right, so we're transforming, kind of like transformers, the original image, or called that pre-image, into something else, okay? So let's see. Here's my x-axis. A is how far away. What's over 2, up 2, so it's going to be the same thing. Over 2, but now what? Down 2. So if I'm sketching it, this should be at negative 2, because I went down. So this is my little A prime. If you have already done this one as A prime, B prime, C prime, I could even do the double prime. That is allowed. I'm not making that up. All right, so let's just do these as double primes. For now, I wouldn't suggest you do that in your class, because typically a double prime means that you took this reflection and then changed it again. So for now, though, we're just going to take it to mean the second thing that I'm doing on my board for right this second, okay? So A prime is where? Over 2, down 2. All right, where's my B prime? And again, I'm calling it double prime here. I'm going to change my mind, Hannah. I really feel like that's going to mess up kids if I do it that way, and I don't want that to be the case because I want to use appropriate language. So the red A prime was the first reflection. Now the purple A prime is going back to the pre-image, and there's a different reflection, so you can see the difference between the two. All right, what about B? If I take this B, how far is it from X? Well, I went over 2, and then I went up 6. So how far is it from X? It's going to still be over 2, but down what? 6. Instead of going up, I'm going to go down. So the 2 stayed the same. The only thing that changed was that second number. So this B here is going to be at negative 6. All right, let's do C. For C, I went over 4, up 2. So how far is C from the x-axis? It's up 2, so it's going to be the same distance on the x, but now going down to negative 2. So over 4, down 2. As I'm connecting these, what do you notice is the pattern for these particular points? If I'm doing an x-axis reflection, what changed as far as my coordinates? Well, the 2 went to a 2. That didn't change. The 2 here, the y, became a negative 2. Same thing happened for the other three, or other two points. Those three points all show that the way that you would, without graphing, if you had to come up with a rule or a formula, if I go from my image or my pre-image, my normal points are all going to change by just the y value being the opposite of whatever it was before. So that's the difference between a y-axis reflection and an x-axis reflection. Hope that helped a little bit. I know for me, I'm a highly visual person, so I want to be able to see, you know, what happened, and I would draw it out for myself to be able to even, you know, check my points and make sure that those are accurate. All right, with that being said, we have some exciting news. We have some t-shirt winners already. From Shields, we have Halima, I'm so sorry. From Farrell, Dania. You guys are testing me out on your names tonight. And then from Barrington, we got JJ. I cannot mess that one up. All right, so congratulations. You'll be getting, again, one of these snazzy t-shirts. We expect to see you wearing those around town as we go around to school sites. And wear it proudly, because you have been doing the math. All right, back to you, Hannah.
All right, we're going to change the transformation. Right now, we're going to go towards dilation. You talked very briefly about dilation. Here is the action. We're going to take that dilation word into action and get it to work. It says here dilation with a scale factor of 3 and center of origin 0 and 0. This is O for origin. Order pair 0 and 0, which is this point here. This point here is our origin, O, with coordinates 0 and 0. This is the center of dilation. What do you mean, Hannah, center of dilation? Learn this. This is physics more than anything else. Center of dilation means if I have a light bulb put here, shedding its light on this triangle with a factor of 3 means it's going to enlarge it like the projector that you see at school. Okay? Here's the projector. It's going to shed its light on this picture, take it to the screen. Here's the screen. What we're going to see on the screen is this same picture enlarged. You say, well, how do you know, Hannah, it's going to enlarge? Maybe it would shrink. Okay? Well, because the factor is more than 1, then it's going to enlarge. It's going to grow bigger. Okay? How do you do that? There are two different ways to do it. One way, since we're doing with the center, where the bulb is, the light bulb is, then we're going to do it the graphic way. Okay? So this is order pair 2 and 2. You take this 3 and times it by every one of these coordinates, and that would generate the A prime for you. So 3 times 2 is 6. 3 times 2 is 6. So now count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here is the A prime, everybody. The A prime. Yes. Where is the B prime, Hannah? I say, well, the 4 is now going to be times by 3, and that would generate 12. And the negative 1 is going to multiply by 3, it's going to generate negative 3. So let's go count 12. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. I'm going to expand this here. And I'm going to go 11, 12. I hope you can see that. Okay? And now we're going to go down what? We're going to take that negative 1 and multiply it by 3 also, so it would be negative 3. So go here and count negative 3, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3 is going to be about here. So this is, ladies and gentlemen, this is the point that we're going to call B prime. C prime, where are you? C prime says, well, C is 2 and negative 1, order pair 2 and negative 1, multiplied by 3. 3 times 2, everybody, is 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And now, down what? Down 3, because I'm going to multiply the 3 by the negative 1. Take me to negative 3. 1, 2, 3. And here is my C prime. And look how enlarged this triangle has become. Here is the triangle. I'm going to connect it in a different color. I know you like purple, so we're going to connect it in purple. Here's the image. Connect. Connect. And connect. You connect the three vertices, two at a time, and you generate the image of this triangle ABC, which is triangle A prime, B prime, C prime. Now, I have some comments to say about this. Notice that the scale factor is 3, and you get this scale factor, watch this, the scale factor, because there is a controversy regarding scale factor. Some people believe by mistake, okay, and I say that by mistake, openly and clearly, that the scale factor would equal the ratio between the very original to the very image. No. Here's the correct answer. The scale factor, everybody, is simply the ratio between the image ratio the original. You say, so how can I get that? If I gave you this picture here, without any of this, how can you figure out the scale factor? You say, well, Hannah, where's the original? I say, here's my original. This is my original. And Hannah, where is my image? I say, here's my image. I say, okay, I can go take any length from the image, divide it by its original. You count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You count 1, 2. So now it's 6 divided by 2, and this would generate your 3, which is right there. See, the 3 is the scale factor. If I gave you the 3 and I wanted you to find the image, this is one way of asking you the question. Or I may give you the original and the image and say, guys, I need my scale factor. So what do? You say, okay, here's my image, here's my original, divide this by this, bingo, you have the scale factor. 6 divided by 2, everybody, is 3. You don't like this side and this side? No problem. Go count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Divided by 1, 2, 3. And guess what? 9 divided by 3 is also 3. All right? So whether you divide 6 by 2, you get the 3, which is the scale factor, or you divide 9 by 3, you get the 3, which is the scale factor. So here's the very clear message I want to send to everybody, whether, you know, youngsters, adults, everybody. Okay, please listen. We need to stick with this scale factor concept here. It is not any other than the ratio between the image to the original. Okay? If you think by mistake that saying the scale factor means the ratio between this to this, sorry, you're wrong. And let's make corrections. We all do mistakes. I do mistakes every day. And I correct myself. I learn from my own mistakes. Okay? Here is dilation, everybody. Original, scale factor, image. All these words are fancy words. I hope you gather them all together and don't let go with them. Because now comes the FSA in a few months, say 4 or 5 months from now, and you will encounter questions of this nature. Okay? And of course, your tests in class and your homework assignments and so forth. Maggie, back to you.
All right, Hannah. So I have been playing with my board here, with my pegboard, and I wanted to show you what I'm coming up with. I'm going to stay on the topic of reflection. I really struggled as a kid, and let's admit it, sometimes even when you're given one of these questions after a little while, you're like, what? What kind of sense am I going to make out of this? So let me show you, when I was looking at the reflections before, we were doing very basic reflections, either on the x-axis or the y-axis, but can you reflect on a different line or about a different point? And the answer is yes. So with my pegboard, I'm going to remove that for just a second, where I'm going to bring it back though so you could see it. If the pre-image, and again, it doesn't have to be a triangle. We've been showing you triangles. It happens to be a rectangle or square, whatever it happens to be. I've already taken the time to go ahead and figure out where those points were. Where were those ordered pairs? So I have it here, again, my points, how would I label them? Go over from the origin, negative 2 up 3, negative 2 up to 6. So you see those, negative 2, 6, negative 2, 3, there they are. And then negative 4 up to 3, and negative 4 up to 6. So I got those there. Try to be cutesy with the letters so it spells out math, but sometimes it doesn't make any sense, the letters that are being used, but that's okay. So now let's say that I want you to reflect on the x equals negative 1 line. You're not reflecting about the x-axis, so it wouldn't be that the image is just directly down here. It wouldn't be on the y-axis reflection, we would have just flipped it over. We really want you to reflect on this line. Well, where in the world is x is equal to negative 1? All right, so you think about it. Where are all the points going to be negative 1? If I were to do a little input-output table, what it would truly look like would be that all the points are negative 1. So whatever value of y I pick, it's always going to be x's of negative 1. So if I do negative 1, 0, boom. Negative 1, 1, boom. What kind of line am I creating? Negative 1, 2. It's going to become a vertical line. So in purple, let me set this down for just a second here. I'm going to show you, if I were to have drawn it really carefully and straight, that purple line is now where I want it to be, that reflection line. So I'm not reflecting on my axes, I'm reflecting on this purple line. So now this picture is going to need to be what? On the opposite side of this purple line, the same distance as the original image or the pre-image was. If I show you this on my pegboard, right over here, make sure that everything is lined up correctly. And do you see that there? 3, yes, okay. So if I were to show you that purple line in green, I'm just going to do this with my rubber band because sometimes it's a little bit easier to see that. Hopefully I'm not going to pop that rubber band on myself. There it is. All right, so now you've seen it in my sketch and you've seen it here on my pegboard. This little rectangle is going to be reflected about this green line, not on the y-axis. What is that going to look like? All right, so this first point, how far is it from that green line? Well, it's just 1/1. All right, so I'm going to put it right there. All right, look at this other point. Don't worry about the names of those points just yet. How far over is it from that green line? Or I count 1, 2, 3. So on the opposite side, it's going to be the same. 1, 2, 3. Did I change how far these two are from each other? Nope. Same distance, so same shape, same size. All right, what about this point? Where is it going to be? On the opposite side of the green line, same distance away. Bam. And then my last point, how far is it from the green line? 1, 2, 3. So 1, 2, 3 on the opposite side. Now visually I look at it. Are these two shapes the same size? Are they looking similar to each other? And I can create my little rubber band rectangle before I do anything else with it. So is that easier to see? Now what becomes a little bit confusing for some of our students is, how do I name now these points? It's actually on the axes, on that y-axis for these two. So let's practice that really, really quickly. For M, which happened to be this one up here, where is M going to be on this shape? Remember, that's the one that was 4 away, actually 1, 2, 3 away from that green line. It's 3 away from this green line here. So this shape, or this point, I'm sorry, now becomes this point over here, right? So where is that M going to now be? Read it from the origin. Over to the right, 2, and then up how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So M became 2. I'm going to use the same color so I am not confusing anyone. Let's see here. It was over 2 and then up. Wait. Yep, over 2, up 2, 6. What happened to the A? Where was A at before? A is this one here. It became this new A point. How do I know? It's the same distance away from that green line. So how do I name that point? Well, how many did I move side to side? 0. How many did I go up? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that becomes 0, 6. Anyone noticing a pattern? All right, what about the T? The T was this point right here. It was 1, 2, 3 away from the green line. So 1, 2, 3 away. So this blue dot became this new red one. How do I name that point? To the right, 2, and up, 1, 2, 3. So that was 2, 3. And then lastly, this H, which was this point right here. How do I name that new point H, that new H prime? 0 side to side and up, 1, 2, 3. All right, so if I did this correctly, I should notice a pattern. All of my Y values are the same, right? Because the only thing that shifted was where they were on the X axis. They didn't shift how far up they were from that X, right? So the Y value stayed the same. What changed? Well, this one went from a -4 to a +2. What did I do to go from a -4 to a +2? So think about your integers. I needed to have added what? 6. Is that the same rule from -2 to 0? Something happened here, Hannah. What happened? I'm going to take a look at that as I reflect on that. So get it? Reflect. But looking for that rule to see what happened. Something to do here with this -1, all right? So just showing you that for sure, whenever you do a reflection that doesn't look like it's just on the x-axis or the y-axis, you're going to have to find out where that line is, and it'll be the same idea, it's just a different line that you're reflecting on. All right, that sounded like a long-winded answer, but back to you, sir, because I believe you're doing rotations.
Thank you so much. Yes, we are. We're going to rotate together. All right, are you ready? Let's get and rotate together. Rotation is one of those transformations that are very friendly and very simple to do. Let's see how we can rotate a figure in real action, in real world. Let's take a look. Here is a figure that is, as you can tell, a rectangle, A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D. We want to rotate this figure. For rotation, we have to have what center of the rotation we are rotating about, And what kind of angle? This angle could be any measure angle, okay? We chose 180 now because we don't have a protractor handy and do the very tiny measures and stuff. So we're going to do the 180. 180 is so simple to do in any situation. Even if you are walking in the mall and you want to do 180, just do 180. I mean, it's simple to do, okay? We know how to do the 360. You go around yourself and back to where your position originally was. The 180 is to just, instead of looking forward, you basically look backward. Instead of looking eastern, you look western, and so on. That's 180. You make that 180 degree rotation. And by the way, whether it is rotation of 180 degrees or rotation of negative 180 degrees, this angle 180 is so unique because if we rotate it clockwise or counterclockwise, we're going to end in the same position, in the same, you know, destination. So let's get started. I want you to learn three steps for rotation. One is to connect, and I would explain. Two is to extend. And three is to measure. Connect. Here's step one, everybody. I'm going to act with A first. I'm going to rotate A around the original. I'm sorry, this is origin here. This is my rotation center or center of rotation. So I'm going to connect. Connect what, Hannah? Connect the point to the center of rotation. Here it is. Now I connected. Step two is to expand this or extend this. Here we go. I'm expanding or extending it. Now it's like this. And now measure. Measure what? First of all, why did we extend? Because it's 180. It's not always the case. If it is not 180, I would have said measure the angle. But now because it's 180, when you measure 180 here, this is 180 degrees. So you basically expand or extend this line segment or this ray, and you are measuring 180 degrees. Do I need a protractor for this? Not really. Everyone can expand, and everyone knows that this straight angle is nothing other than 180 degrees. So we have met our criteria, 180 degrees. Now measure. Measure means what? Measure means you get your compass from the origin to the point A, go to the other side, and take the same distance. When I measure this and go to the same distance on the other side, I would end with this point here, everybody, as my A prime. Congratulations, we got A prime. Now we go to B, find B prime. To find B prime, we're going to do the same process. I'm going to connect to the origin. Here it is. Connect. Now, after you connect, expand. And here I am expanding. And now, measure the third one. Measure. Measure what? Measure this distance. Take exactly the same distance with your compass. Put your needle here, measure this distance, and go to the other side. You measure this same distance on the other side, you come to this point here. Congratulations, everybody. We got B prime determined already. That's good news. Now we do C. Same process. C, connect. Here's C. Expand. Connected and expanded in one shot. Now it's measuring. Take this and go to the other side. Here we go. Here is C prime. D, you're the last one, D. I'm going to take care of you right now. Connect. You connect D to the origin. And expand or extend. And now you measure. Measure this on the other side. It's right here. Here is D prime. Class, we have A prime, B prime, C prime, and D prime determined. Let's now connect them and generate our beautiful rectangle, which is an image by rotation. And if you notice, the original and the image are of the same size. No change. It's not a dilation. It's a rotation. Same in reflection. If you noticed what kind of image we get when we do reflection, same as translation. If you notice what kind of image we get when we do translation, these three transformations, everybody, are called rigid transformations, as Maggie just said a while ago. We call them rigid. You know why we call them rigid? Because they don't change sizes. They continue to preserve sizes. If this is a 2-unit, guess what? AD, here's A prime, D prime, 2-unit. If this is a 6-unit, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, guess what? A prime, B prime is also 6 units. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If this angle is 90-degree angle, guess what? This angle is 90-degree angle. And this is the beauty about rigid transformations. They are called rigid because they preserve two things. Length of sides, 6, 6, 2, 2, 6, 6, 2, 2, and measures of angles, 90, 90, 90, 90, 90, 90, 99. And that's the beauty of being a rigid transformation. Do we have all transformations we're studying are rigid? No. We have one transformation that is not rigid. It's called dilation. It's very fluid. It changes the sizes. Doesn't change the measures of the angles, though. We're going to get to dilation in a minute. We'll hope that the time would allow us to cover dilation also. I have one problem. We did one before, but let's just encounter one more of the dilation or the similarity, which would show us clearly that it changes the size of the sides, yes, but it preserves the measures of the angles. We're going to discuss this in a minute. Back to you, Maggie.
All right, you guys, we have some more T-shirts to give away. So we're really excited about that. So more T-shirts going out too. Are you ready? Maniscalco, we have Ari, McLean. At McLean, we have Jamal. And at Man, we have Jonathan. So thank you for calling in tonight and speaking to our teachers. Don't forget, we have a little bit more time left. You can definitely call in and we can do one of your questions on air, and the teachers are still answering your phone calls. All right, so we're gonna go now to translations. And with translations, we're not translating languages like from Spanish to English or English to Spanish or any of that. With a translation, this is what's called a slide. Now you can take your original picture. I'm gonna use that rectangle that I was using before, and I'm gonna slide it somehow. So it's kind of almost like if I took it up here on this pegboard, it's as if I took it in that original picture and it's like I lifted it off the page and then slide it down, slide it over. Each of the corners remains the same as the original picture. So this top left corresponds to this top left. This top right corresponds to that top right, same with the bottom too, all right? So using that same idea, I'm just gonna remove this and I'm gonna actually use both the pegboard and my little sketch here. The blue is the pre-image. The red is the new image, which I have to show my prime, A prime, M prime, T prime, and H prime. If this is already given to you, the picture is given to you, but now the question becomes, what kind of translation did I do? Sometimes the clue, like I was showing you before, can be found in the actual ordered pairs, but sometimes it becomes a little bit tricky. So as a visual, what did I do to this M point to go from the blue M to the red M? So I shifted it down and I shifted it over, right? So down and then to the right. Can I tell how many I went down? Well, down is my y-axis, or my y number of my ordered pair. I went from a 6 to a negative 1. So how do I go from a 6 to a negative 1? Well, I would subtract 7. So on your grid, does that look true? So I'm gonna go from this blue to this red. So down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Absolutely. And then how many did I go to the right? 2 spots. So basically the rule is going to be whatever my x value is, I'm going to take 7 away. And then whatever my y value is, I'm going to do what? Actually, looking at that again, be careful because I'm getting ready to make a mistake here. So I'm going to go over to the right 2 spots. So I'm going to add what? 2. The reason I'm saying be careful is if I mix these two up, it may cause some serious issues in my points, right? So I went from this negative 4 to this negative 2. I really did what? I added 2. So the adding of 2, was that done to the x or to the y? That was done to the x point. So this is x plus 2. Now what happened to my y's? It went from a 6 to a negative 1. So from the 6 to the negative 1, I subtracted 7. So I took 7 away because I went down. So remember, depending on how you go, I could have said I moved it over and then down. So just be careful with that order because it definitely matters. So y take away what? 7. Is that true for each of these other points? So let's test it. Negative 2 plus 2, that's 0. 6, take away 7, that's negative 1, absolutely. Negative 4 plus 2, negative 2. 3, take away 7, negative 4. And from negative 2 to 0, definitely add the 2. 3, take away 7, negative 4. So it's almost like I'm finding my rule. So what you could say is that I shifted my points down 7 and to the right 2, and this is what that would show you. So you could say the translation was down 7, and then what? To the right 2. Just again, double check always that you have that in proper position.
I'd rather if we can write the right 2.
You
want to
do the right one first?
Yeah.
All right.
Because
so Hannah's saying, let's do right 2, so like that it doesn't become so confusing, and then down 7. But on your actual grid, you guys, you could either see it one way or the other. Just make sure you keep those, you know, straight. What happened first? You went right 2. So here I could have said this one went right 2 and then down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Same idea. All right, so keeping that straight in line with if you think of it as your ordered pairs. All right, so that's a translation where you just take and lift those points up and move them sideways and down or down and sideways, whichever you want, but just make sure you keep it straight when it comes to your ordered pairs. All right, back to you, sir.
Well, thank you so much, Maggie. And this brought some other idea that I want to share with our friends watching about that translation thing. The reason I mentioned let's stick with x movement first is because later on, you're going to encounter the translation written in this form. Let's take a look at my board. The translation will be written as this. Watch. T, and then they give you big pair of parentheses like this, long and narrow. And here they put 2 and negative 7. What this means, that this translation would the top one is the x movement, and the bottom one is the y movement. So you're going to move 2 to the right and down 7. So it's always known to have that x movement on the top and the y movement on the top, on the bottom. So I'd rather, that's why we changed to x movement first and then y movement second. Now, look at what we have on my board here. And I wish we can remove that number for a minute.
The phone number?
Yeah, if we can, so that the picture would show clear. Thank you very much. What you see here is something to do with similarity. We say that this rectangle, A, B, C, D, is similar to, you say, Hannah, why didn't you write is similar to? You just said is similar to, but you did not write is similar to. I say, well, yeah, I wrote it. This is what is similar to looks like. This sign reads is similar to. Rectangle, A prime, B prime, C prime, D prime. This reads is similar to. And this, again, reminds me of one other piece of information that I want to share with you. You see, this reads is similar to. This reads equals to. And when you put the two together, like this, this reads is congruent to. Because what you see here, similarity, guarantees the look. We don't have anything to do with this now. This is out of the picture. What you see here that is similar to guarantees the look is the same. This guarantees that the size is the same. And when the look is the same and the size is the same, we get to the congruency. Then the figures are congruent. Okay, everybody? This is how they developed this symbol. This symbol was not randomly chosen. It was a combination of the similarity symbol and the equal symbol to guarantee the look and the size. If the two things have the same look and the same size, we call them congruent. Now, with these two rectangles being congruent, being similar, there is what we call a dilation also. You can call this ABCD a dilation of, A prime, B prime, C prime, D prime is a dilation of the ABCD. Hannah, what's the scale factor of that dilation? From small to big. Now, the scale factor, remember, SF for scale factor is always, as we mentioned earlier, is none other than the image ratio, the original. You say, okay, show me numbers, Hannah. I say, okay, let's take any image. The purple is the image. And here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 for D prime C prime, for example. So I put 4, ratio. The original here is DC is 1, 2, 2. So now the scale factor is 2. All right, everybody? Now, I want you to take it from here to the perimeter 1, ratio perimeter 2, area 1, ratio area 2. We're going to learn a lot within this minute or two left, okay? Here, if I wanted to compare the perimeter 1 to perimeter 2, I would go find the perimeter of the original, 1, 2, 1, 2, that is 4, 6 and 6, that's 12, 4 and 12 add up to 16. Ratio, the purple one, 4 and 4, that is 8, now 12 and 12, 24, 8 and 12, 8 and 24 add up to 32. P1, ratio P2. The perimeter 1, ratio perimeter 2, as this length, ratio length, is 1 to 2, yes, the image is twice the original, but now the original is half of the image, okay? So now this is 1 to 2 also. The perimeter would remain to be in the same ratio as the original side to its image side. Now, that's the perimeter to perimeter. No change whatsoever. 1 to 2, perimeter to perimeter is 1 to 2. What about areas? How many of this rectangle can I fit in this big rectangle? Believe it or not, you take that factor 2, you take this factor 2, and twice it. And that would be 4. Believe it or not. 2, everybody, times 6 is 12. This is 12 unit squared area. 4 times 8, 4 times 12 is 48. This is here, 48. This is the area of the big one. When you think of 48, it's 4 times 12, and that is how the area is compared to the area. Now, the area here, area 1 to area 2, that would be 1 to 4, 1 ratio 4, because now the factor is 1 half that we went with this being half of this, this being twice this. So that area 1, if I put area 1 as the small one, area 2 is the large one, I would go to 1 to 4. If I went area 2 first, that would be 4 times as much as this. Ladies and gentlemen, we can talk forever, never have enough time to do all what we want to do or desire to do, but we're tied up with the time. Time is over, believe it or not. The hour flew by. And thanks to Mathnasium for your support, continue supporting us. And we would always want you, audience, to check their website and check our website and see how you can learn math more and more every day. And keep watching Math Homework Online and spread the word about Math Homework Online. Back to you, Maggie.
All right, you guys. That wraps up our first show of 2020. Have a great evening. Thank you, Mathnasium. Bye.